Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Sanjay Sarma. I'm professor of mechanical engineering at MIT, and I'm also the vice president for open learning. What a wonderful gathering this is. This is really siblings and cousins and brothers and sisters in the open education movement. Knowledge is like oxygen. I hope no one figures out how to charge for oxygen. I hope we figure out a way in which we never charge for knowledge. It should be like the air. We should breathe it. We are at a very interesting point in time. MIT faculty, speaking for my own colleagues, have an opportunity to learn from senior leaders at HBCUs who are promoting educational equity by spearheading OER, open education resources within their institutions. And we're looking at MIT to include culturally relevant materials in our own courses. This effort is an invaluable resource for discovering a more inclusive canon of OER. Now, the hope really is that my colleagues adapt these OER materials created by HBCUs and colleagues in our own courses here, and then we share them back with the world through OpenCourseWare. And so this way we can collectively promote educational equity, not only within our MIT community, but in the nation and perhaps the world. The question really for us today is, how can we do this today? How can we do this together? And this is just the first conversation. How do we establish a metabolism of open educational resources, especially around equity and around, in this particular case, for our discussion, around materials that are culturally relevant? So I would like to particularly thank two colleagues, Robbie Melton and Jerry Hanlon, for doing this great event and the amazing panelists. And I welcome you to this. And with that, I'll hand off to my friend and colleague, Kurt Newton from MIT.
Thank you, Sanjay. Just a couple of housekeeping notes before we dive in. We're gonna try to use the chat collectively in the spirit of conversation as we're going. Please enter your questions in the chat, and I'll encourage our presenters here to engage, and feel free to answer directly as we're going. We are recording, and as we get into the Q&A at the end, just if you don't want to appear in the video, suggest that you keep your video turned off. I'd like to thank, along with all of our participants here today who have joined us, also, thank the Hewlett Foundation for facilitating this introduction between MIT Open Learning and these HBCU leaders, and to our colleagues across the Open 2030 Working Group for the inspiration over the past couple of years. And again, just reiterating Sanjay's closing remark, we hope that this is the first of what will be many, many ongoing conversations. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Dr. Robbie Melton.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Robbie Melton, and today we are going to help history in the making. Again, I'm Robbie Melton on behalf of the Historically Black Colleges and University and Tennessee State University. We are here to share our passion, our purpose, but today we all, colleagues, will make history. I already had a presentation for you, and you'll see by my slides, but I'm going to go off script on purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of all educators in the world, we all are in a war. Today, we're not going to just talk about open education. We're going to do something about it on behalf of the people of Ukraine who are now leaving their homes, leaving their schools, leaving their history. Today, we're going to share with you why we have the cultural collection. We are here to demonstrate, all of us, what we can do with the mighty tool of technology. Today, as we present and share with you the purpose of a cultural collection, not only for the HBCU, but for the world. We dedicate this presentation to those diversity, inclusive, all of those words that we hear today. We're going to do something about it. So I have my team already in the chat. And as we go through this presentation, this is what we're going to do. We are going to capture the culture of the Ukraine as they try to take it away with open education, which means open to everyone. I'm going to have you, because you know how to multitask while you're at your computer, I'm going to have you to find on the internet history, famous people, whatever about the Ukraine. And you're going to put that URL in the chat. My team will capture that URL highlighting the Ukraine and their contribution to education. Because by the time you wake up tomorrow morning, we will have a cultural collection on behalf of the Ukraine people. They will not lose their history nor their education. All of you should celebrate on behalf of the Hewlett Foundation why a cultural collection is so vital to open education. And with that, we are all now responsible because we have the tool of technology to help underserved population, and we're going to do it today. So with that, everyone, I'm going to go through my presentation, but you have homework to do. While you're at that computer listening, I need for you to start searching. Get on Google, get on those search engines, and find information about the Ukraine so that we can put it in a special collection. That's what we can do together. So with that, I will start my presentation, but we are here again for a purpose. The purpose of the cultural collection for the HBCU, the same as every other underserved population. It is to bring to the world our contribution, our achievement, and to share. So with that, on behalf of the 106 HBCU sisters, we come to you with a curation of our history, our achievement. How about our distinguished faculty members? So as we roll this away, we again can change this whole world, and we can do something about it. So with that, again, the next slide will share with you our cultural collection and our underlying purpose right now. Everybody, students cannot learn from books they can't afford. We all know that. And unfortunately, in our day, people are trying to restrict books. They're trying to destroy books. We together, all 75 of us, can make sure we have access to education and books. Next slide, please. So with that, everyone, you all know the cost of textbooks. Here's some old numbers because inflation already jumped up the price of textbooks. Right now, the average cost, $1,200. You might think, wow, that's okay. No, it's not okay. Again, students cannot learn from books they cannot afford. Next slide. So with that, let me just share with you the impact of textbook costs on students. Again, you see the statistics. Some take fewer courses. Some don't even register for a specific course. Or how about you just drop out or withdraw? Here's the one that you should center on. Earn a poor grade because I could not afford to buy the textbook. Fail a course because I couldn't afford, or guess what, everyone? You don't purchase the required book at all. Open education, that's what we are here for. But within open education, next slide, please. We missed a little component. And so we were able to conduct, hot off the press, a faculty and student survey report. And okay, you all know, we know that we need to inform more. We need to contribute more. But guess what else we found? We found, next slide, that we were missing a whole component, a cultural selection. Our students, our faculty, our communities kept saying, thank you for open education. Thank you for a free textbook. Thank you for affordable learning solution. However, next slide, please. You will see that they also found that they didn't find culturally relevant materials. Look at the numbers. This should say something. Again, we have in our hands the tools, knowledge, to do something about this. So on behalf of the HBCUs, guess what? We formed, through a partnership with Merlo, merlo.org. All right, everybody put merlo.org right there, because Jerry Hanley, who you're gonna hear in a few minutes, stepped up with his open education portal to say, let's do something about it. So that's why you are here. We're here to share with you, not what we're going to do, quote unquote. We're here to share with you what we have completed. The next slide will share with you on behalf of the support from the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. And yes, I'm gonna call out Angela. Yes, Angela DeBarger. She listened. The Hewlett Foundation said, there's a need. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to present to you with a panel, a distinguished panel. And now with the partnership of MIT, that we are able to curate, highlight, showcase, and give you just a little taste of our HBCU cultural collection. Next slide, thank you. So on behalf again of the historically Black College and University, you must be asking again, The purpose, you're gonna learn something today. Number two, you're gonna do something today. Number three, on behalf of the HBCUs, we celebrate all cultures. Next slide. So I am pleased to share with you, I need a drum roll, that our cultural collection includes not just general information, biography, Black History Month, HBCU history, but we are able to address diversity, equity, inclusiveness, all within this open education portal. Again, access from all over the world, that anytime, any place, any type of whatever that can hook up to that internet, you have this rich resource right there at your fingers. So with that, with our cultural collection, next slide, please. I'm here to highlight again our need. And guess what? They're gonna put it in the chat right now, because you can go to it right now. And again, just think, you all logged on only 8 minutes ago, and now you have the richness of the HBCU community right there for you. Next slide, please. So, on a partnership, that's what all of this about. Kurt and MIT, we're talking relationship, partnership, sharing. where on behalf of the National Museum of African American History and Culture, we already have curated for you where you don't even have to search and dig and all that deep diving. No, we want it up front and center. We have curated for you on behalf of the HBCs anything you can think of regarding our history and contribution. And next slide, please. And as you view this, we now want to talk about how do we get the word out? How do we expand? Everyone, we have a model. So it's not just, oh, we're going to inform, oh, we're going to be strategic. We are piloting what we call our OER campus implementation. We know it has to start and be supported from the top, but we have to talk about sustainability. We have to talk about how do you engage your faculty? And beyond that, we're talking community here. We're talking the world. How do we get it out? So we include, as you see, an adoption plan that starts with the college. Who? Everyone? We're talking about the college chair to the faculty. And the next slide will share with you. We thought if we could have two or more from a department to engage, to create, to remix, to redistribute all of OER materials, we would see impact. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to share with you, we have impact. That's why we're here today to share. So you see our deployment finding, how we started with campus awareness, faculty training, course redesign, and pilot, as well as research. Next slide. And now I'm here to share with you, in a few minutes, you're gonna hear from our regional hubs. We know that touch and technology must go together. Our regional hubs are able to touch other affiliates within our HBCU family. And boy, wait till you see in a few seconds what they have to share. So with that next slide, again, with the help of Merlo, www.merlo.org. Yes, you can drink it too. I want you to know on behalf of higher education, not just for the HBCUs, but for the whole world. We are global. We have communities in all disciplines, and we have peer review. But Jerry Hanley, I would like to bring him on. But again, you should be searching. We're going to do something about that cultural collection for the Ukraine. Jerry Hanley.
Hello, everyone. Jerry Hanley here from Merlo Skills Commons and California State University, Long Beach. And I just want to say it's just a pleasure to be a partner with so many of the friends here within our HBCUs. And just going to say a few quick things about what Merlo brings to the table in partnership to really pursue the passions and the purposes that Robbie has outlined. So the first thing I think, one of the things is, as Robbie laid out, you need an institutional strategy in order to really bring a community of people together. Because only together can you really solve some of these very challenging problems. And when we bring the affordable learning solutions, so we begin with what is the learning solutions that will enable our students to be successful and our faculty to teach their discipline, then how do you make it affordable? And that has been a critical element. And for over 10 years, Merlo has been working on this, and with a grateful support from the Hewlett Foundation over the many years of doing this, we begin to customize these programs to fit into the unique campus cultures of each institution. And I think, as Robbie pointed out, around building the collection, well, this is where the technical infrastructure, where Robbie and her colleagues at the HBCU say, Jerry, we need a bookshelf for Black History Month. Well, it's easy to put that metadata structure in there, create customized portals. And within the last 6 months, over 500 new materials were created and contributed into the Merlot's Africana culture collection. And then finally, an important capability in order for each of us to create inclusive strategies of content and pedagogical strategies, that you have to enable the remixing and the revising of content so it can be aligned with your local needs of your students and your faculty and your community. And that's one of the powers of OER, is that it's an enabling that process. And by working with both open source applications and commercial providers to enable that remixing and revising is going to be very important in order to close the equity gaps that are so pervasive in education, both in the US and around the world. So with that, I'm going to pass it off back to the Tennessee State University National Hub, who has been just amazing in their leadership. So back to you.
And I welcome the Tennessee Hub serving as that hub for the HBCUs with the cultural collection. I bring on the Tennessee Hub.
Hello, everyone. And I am Dr. Deborah Chisholm, Executive Director at Tennessee State University for OER. I also have with me my two colleagues, Dr. Ampadu and Dr. Hassel, who will introduce themselves after I finish presenting. Next slide, please. TSU HBCU Affordable Learning Solutions. The Tennessee State University is the national hub. Coordination of HBCU OER training, HBCU OER faculty and student survey, coordination of HBCU OER webinars, HBCU OER library resources, coordination of HBCU OER pilots, and coordination of the cultural collection as well. Next slide, please. Did you know at Tennessee State University, we have 33 OER pilot faculty members. We also have 14 departments, 2 faculty members per department, and 17 OER campus webinars for 2021. Next slide, please. Our impact at Tennessee State University, a student savings of $81,000 this past fall semester with just 33 faculty members using the free OER materials. And now I'll pass it to Dr. Ampadu. Dr. Ampadu?
Thank you so much, Dr. Chisholm. Hello, my name is Dr. Ampadu Moss. I am the director of HBCU OER here at the great Tennessee State University. We help coordinate HBCU OER webinars, HBCU OER surveys, academic communities, and OER faculty outreach. Next slide. When we help our faculty members, we are able to allow them to come to an amazing portal where they can go to the TSU Excel for Ed and find OER materials. We can showcase our faculty members. We can have academic communities. We'll have accessibility for the faculty members and their students. We find other OER resources that are readily available with different strategies and tips they can use in the classroom. And then of course, the HBCU pilots that we do every semester. Now with one of our pilot studies, our faculty members, their responses for 2021, they stated that there is a need for training on the use of the Creative Commons licensing, that there is an increase of cultural collections. There is a need for updated discipline related OER materials, and there is a need for faculty training regarding the creation of OER materials. So after we gathered that information, we said, okay, what are we going to do? We decided to have webinars every Tuesday at 3:30 where the faculty members can go ahead and click on so we can help fill the gap and fill all the needs of the faculty members. And now I want to go ahead and pass it on to the amazing Dr. Robert Hassel.
Thank you, Dr. Ampadu. I am Dr. Robert Hassel, TSU Learning Support Staff here providing and the OER Student Success Consultant Coordinator here at Tennessee State University. Next slide, please. We decided to poll all of the students and we got feedback from surveys and they gave us the following recommendations concerning our student population. That there was a need for OER awareness and benefits among the students. And there is a need for on-hand workshops and the need for culturally related materials. And this response indicated that there was a need for more information in their particular disciplines of study. Next slide, please. One of the most phenomenal things we were able to do here at Tennessee State University is create an open educational resource student success coach at TSU. We also established our OER bibliography of TSU current students, staff, and alumni, which we are proud to give you a glimpse of today. Here's a recap of our amazing alumni here in the land of golden sunshine at Tennessee State University. Dr. Glenda Bastens Glover, who is our 8th institutional president and the first woman president. She is the international president of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated.
Next, we have the amazing Ed Temple. And Ed Temple has strove so hard to get 43 TSU Olympians to the Olympics every year.
Oprah Winfrey is a talk show host, philanthropist, and notable alumni of Tennessee State University. She is best known for The Oprah Winfrey Show, broadcast in Chicago, which is the highest rated television program of its kind in history.
And then we have the great Jesse Russell Sr., who, if you pick up your phones and you see that little triangle that says data, he created that, he patented that, and he was also the first African-American to be hired by AT&T. Thank you so much. Now we'll pass it along to our partners.
And yes, and I have my phone right here. So again, audience, this to give you a little taste of the purpose of the cultural collection. So we'll start with our partner institution, Central State. On behalf of President Thomas and Ms. Dr. Arlene McSwain, I'm here to share with you on their behalf with Open Education Resources and this support. I'm pleased to share with you, they have not only courses, but they have certificate and degree program using 100% OER. Ladies and gentlemen, that means that those students are ready the first day, first minute of class, because what? Open Education Resources already in hand. So again, that Central State as established by Dr. Arletha McSwain. Our next partner coming up, I would like to introduce to you, will be Southern University at Shreveport. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Veronica McEachin, and she's going to let you know how they pulled the whole department together. Take it away.
Greetings from Southern University at Shreveport, under the leadership of Dr. Pennin, our interim chancellor, and Dr. Barry Hester, our interim vice chancellor. This is a great opportunity to share some information with you. I would like to share some history briefly with you. I started helping faculty members find open education resources in 1999, before it was actually named, at Wiley College in Marshall, Texas. In 2012, we developed our online courses using OER under the leadership of Dr. Kim Long. I then moved to Southern University at Shreveport in 2014 and started introducing OER to the campus. At first, I received a lot of pushback from the faculty. However, I developed a strategy to work with those that work with me and constantly encouraged other faculty members to participate. Dr. Wanda Wally recommended that we focus on developing general education courses. After developing the general education courses in OER, using OER in 2016, this automatically made most of our programs OER hybrid because we are a two-year community college. In 2017, we developed our second 100% online program in criminal justice using OER. The criminal justice faculty members decided to use the OER course materials in their face-to-face classes. All criminal justice students start the first day of class with their course material ready to be used at no cost. Moving fast forward into the present, this opportunity allows Southern University at Shreveport to continue developing the core courses to build 100% online programs using open educational resources. We are currently developing a 100% online program in psychology, and we are developing courses for our non-science students in biology and chemistry. Our faculty members that are currently working in the project, they are called the design team. We meet every Monday for about 30 minutes, and we're preparing to present this information to our entire faculty, teaching and sharing with them lessons learned. So again, we would like to thank Dr. Robbie Melton, Dr. Jerry Hanley, and their team for providing training and support for our campus so that we can continue developing 100% online programs using free resources. Thank you for this opportunity.
And of course, we thank you so much. And again, did you hear that? Criminal justice, totally online. Psychology. And again, anywhere, any place, anywhere in the world, you can tap in on those resources ready for you right now. I'm pleased now to share with you a friend, John Jock, again from Edward Waters University. And he's going to give you a perspective globally where we are able to make a difference to a country in need of open education resources.
Greetings, everyone. I cannot even begin to tell you how happy I am to be here this morning or afternoon representing Edward Waters University on this wonderful open education journey. I want to thank our two affiliate institutions, Lawson State Community College and Denmark Technical College, for joining with us in this effort. Our main priority is to make a college education attainable and accessible to as many students as possible through OER, because we believe that education is a fundamental human right. Therefore, we should not allow anything to hinder the success of anyone or any group in their pursuit of an education. And that's why we're here today. Edward Waters University is distinctively Florida's oldest independent institution of higher education, higher learning, as well as the state's first institution established for the education of African Americans. From the beginning, EWU was faced with both abject poverty and widespread illiteracy among its constituents, which explains why even today, 90% of our students are Pell Grant recipients. Thus, what Dr. Robbie Melton and Dr. Jerry Henley are doing for the HBCU community as they facilitate access for our students to open educational resources is beyond miraculous. This is why I am so excited to report that our first OER workshop at EWU, which was held over a week ago, was attended by about 90% of the faculty. Pretty remarkable. So our local ALS team is now motivated to gather data to add to the Merlot's cultural collection, because we do have a story to tell. We are also looking to extend this opportunity to developing countries such as Haiti, where higher education is literally a luxury. I should know, because I'm originally from there. I remember when I was in high school, I had to copy textbook chapters by hand to prepare for an exam, and that was on a regular basis. So I don't have to tell you that this opportunity would be like manna from heaven for the Haitian students. Thank you, Abby. Thank you, Jerry. So what we're doing on our campus is making sure that everybody understands. My responsibility personally is to convey this key message to show our students that we care. We care for their success, we care for their education. And that's why I am so excited about the level of involvement of my faculty and the leadership at the university. So we are ready, we are equipped, and we are thankful for being on this journey. Thank you, everybody.
And we thank you. And again, you see the purpose for a cultural collection. You see the purpose of open education resources. And yes, every day we upload, we search, just like you all are doing now for the Ukraine, so that we can have a cultural collection built. At this time, it is my pleasure to bring on Bethune-Cookman. And you will see for their graduate program, the impact of open education resources.
Good afternoon. Maintaining the spirit of our founder, Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, Bethune-Cookman University allows collaboration to bolster the infusion of open education resources in undergraduate and graduate courses, not only on our campus in Daytona Beach, Florida, but with external partners, Simmons College of Kentucky and Florida A&M University. Currently, 12 graduate faculty members are revamping courses to feature open education resources or function as an OER only course. Next slide, please. A few strategies undertaken by us to propel forward include converting all general education courses to open education resources, persuading 6 of 8 graduate programs and all graduate programs offering online degrees and certificates to include OER or fully convert courses to OER. Currently, there are more than 50 faculty members who have Merlot accounts. We continue to recruit faculty across our partner universities, sharing recordings that highlight discipline-specific OER with faculty is another proven strategy. And finally, being recognized for our OER efforts have all assisted in moving us forward. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, did you hear that? The General Ed Corps, all open education, graduate programs, now you can see together how we can share. So with that, I bring you Morehouse College. Take it away, Dr. Earl Lewis.
Good afternoon and greetings, colleagues. I bring you greetings on behalf of Dr. David A. Thomas, the 12th president of Morehouse College, Dr. Kendrick Brown, provost and senior vice president for academic affairs, and Dr. Clarissa Myrick Harris, the chair of the Division of Humanities. This is how our OER program is anchored at Morehouse College and moving forward with our partners, Claflin University, Clark Atlanta University, and our newest partner, Livingstone College. I, like Dr. McEachran, began using open educational resources as a response to having culturally relevant pedagogical content as a part of my own learning, and then again, when I became a member of the faculty at Florida Memorial University. Today at Morehouse College, next slide, please, our key message is mission-driven. The mission of Morehouse College is to develop men with disciplined minds who will lead lives of leadership and service with special responsibility for advancing knowledge of Black life, history, and culture. So how are we doing OER at Morehouse College? We are engaging it in teaching and learning, faculty development, and service learning. Let me share a few examples. As a part of the teaching and learning, 100% of the Africana Studies faculty and affiliated faculty within the departments of English, History, Journalism, Religion and Philosophy, Cinema, Television and Emerging Media, Music, Mathematics, Computer Science, Business and Economics are using affordable learning solutions. As a part of our fall 2021 semester, we offered 35 sections of our FYE general education courses. 15 sections of those courses, the African American Experience and Introduction to Africana Studies, representing approximately 45% of the FYE courses, were all OER. With this in mind, we estimate that we had a savings of $2,250 per course. This resulted in approximately $33,750 worth of savings for students during the fall semester who were enrolled in our general education courses, the African American Experience. But students, what is the impact? What I am learning, both anecdotally and through the data, is that students remain surprised that their learning can begin before the first day of class by having access to open educational resources and tools to support their learning. Within our partnerships, as we are moving with the faculty development piece, we have engaged a partner through a Healing Paradigm, which is a local wellness and psychological services center, and Dr. Kevin Coakley at UT Austin, who created an open source, culturally relevant text called Making Black Lives Matter, Confronting Anti-Bias and Racism. We're using that text as a foundational resource for facilitating understanding, as well as providing knowledge. It is well-researched, open source, and includes the voices of both undergraduate and graduate students. As a part of our OER commitment to service learning, our Bonner Office for Community Service engages OER through the use of our Apple initiative. They engage coding and creativity and all of the Apple learning resources as a part of their service learning in a one credit lab, as well as a 3 credit hour course. They all become Apple teachers, improve their technology skills, learn how to prototype apps, and do this service in our communities. We are excited to continue this partnership as we move forward, and our Office of Academic Affairs is providing fiscal resources to support faculty research, course redesign, and student internships to conduct research utilizing ALS. So please join us in visiting the HBCU Cultural Collection to learn more about Morehouse and our esteemed alumni. Thank you so much for being here today.
And we thank you so much. And again, everyone, we only got a few more minutes, okay? Remember, all that we have shared is available for you right now. So again, they're going to enter the URL for the HBCU Affordable Learning Solution. And instantly, you have all that we have. We're going to conclude with our network across all of our 106 sister HBCUs. Take it away, Dr. Jacqueline McGehee.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Jacqueline McGee. I am the library director here at Arkansas Baptist College in Little Rock, but I also consider myself as part of the TSU, the Tennessee State University family, and part of the HBCU OER librarian curator. I usually help coordinate strategies and tips and find curated resources for all of the HBCU librarians to help keep OER systems readily available to your faculty, to your students on all of the HBCU campuses. And throughout the year, the best way I found doing this is by consistently staying in discussion with other fellow librarians and finding out what their strengths and threats opportunities and weaknesses are on all the campuses, and using that as a roadmap to help other librarians troubleshoot issues they may be having on their campuses. But several of your libraries have already started to receive information from me on a monthly basis. And like Dr. Melton said, like she spoke about, we are all here to help distribute information to one another. And we just discussed the OER Cultural Collection, which provides a wealth of information from exploring African American and Black study collection on Murlock to exploring free open educational resources related to African topics, exploring OER on diversity, equity, and inclusiveness. But our initial priority is to build the OER Cultural Collection. So each month, there are several of us who actually post items and information like you've just heard to the site. And Dr. Melton, the team, and I, we're all interested in what each of our schools are doing. There's a lot of information that needs to be shared, and this is another way that is possible for us to do so. So uploading information to that website is the key. It's visible to not just the HBCUs, but to the world. And I try to recognize our strengths and weaknesses in other schools. And something that we'll continue to do is help meet the needs and to stay in touch with you all. We will do our best. We're available to help put information on to the site about your school. So if there's anyone that needs to be highlighted, anything that's going on that's very important, please try to reach us so we can get that information out. But we will also do the same for you. So I just want to say thank you again and welcome. And thank you for having me as your library OER curator.
And with that, again, on behalf of the HBCUs, you are able to upload information, share, and we just want to thank, again, the Hewlett Foundation for supporting this need. I have to thank Merlo for coming and helping us to curate, and MIT, Kirk, team, we want to thank you for allowing us to share as you all share with us. So I'm going to turn it over to Kirk before I say my final words, because together we can do this.
Thank you so much, Robbie. I'd like to ask, no, this doesn't quite work the same way as if we're all in the same room together. Can we unmute and just applaud? That is so fantastic what we've been hearing. Yes. I am so energized by the work that you all have been doing. And so it's an honor to just reflect for a moment here before we get into the Q&A on what we've been doing at MIT OpenCourseWare. So for 20 years, MIT faculty has been sharing their teaching materials from a recognition that we need everyone everywhere working together on global challenges, and we need knowledge and other tools to do so. Now, many people come to MIT for STEM resources, right? We think we've reached over 500 million people around the world, students, teachers, independent learners, 2/3 of whom are coming from outside North America. No question, courses like Learning to Program are drawing people, but people are also drawn to the incredible breadth and richness of what we're pulling from across the MIT curriculum. And this, one of our most recent publications, Black Feminist Health Science Studies, is an example. Next slide, please. So OCW at MIT is publishing from across the entire curriculum, all departments, all programs, ranging from introductory undergraduate to the most advanced graduate seminars. It's really a tremendous range of topics. See here on the right a couple of other examples. In addition to learning about programming, students at MIT are learning about the social and ethical responsibilities of computing, and we're sharing that with the world, both for learners and also resources for other teachers to use in their classroom. We're also sharing, for instance, videos in the moment, down the lower right, some videos that we shared from Professor Ama Ito for her seminar on reparations for slavery and colonization, which were posted on our YouTube channel so that the public could engage live in this as it was happening in the class and those comments could be fed back into the classroom. We have voluntary participation from our faculty. We think about 60% have participated. And we're glad to be able to have a team of people, my colleagues on the OCW team, who then do the work of converting those classroom materials, producing the OER versions to be shared with the world. What's in an MIT OCW course? It's really going to vary from class to class, depending on the nature of the subject. You might find notes, you might find readings, documentation of activities and assessments. You'll also find, increasingly, contributions from students because their voice really matters in this experience. You'll find more videos and other rich media, and also interviews with MIT faculty about how and why they teach the way they do to try to create a dialogue with other instructors around the world who are also getting into open education. Last slide, please. So we are excited later this spring, very soon, to be launching Next Generation OCW. There's a new platform, and it starts with working really well on phones, you know, especially for the many people around the world for whom their phone is either their primary or only digital device. Better content discovery tools, better search so that people can find what they're looking for within that amazing collection. But it's not just the platform and the technology. We're also making new investments in enhancing our programs to ensure that the content that we're bringing is constantly vibrant and current and up to date with what's happening at OCW. And in particular, developing and investing in collaborations around the open education ecosystem, in particular, those that are centering equity and creating greater cultural relevance. You know, we want to see more culturally relevant OER all the time and learning how to work together to create and curate and share this, you know, so that we can collectively continue to take on these pressing global challenges. So thank you. Now I'd like to kind of pivot and open it up in our last few minutes here for some Q&A. And I'd like to start by, you know, acknowledging just, you know, Robbie, appreciation for, you know, being so sharp and open-hearted about the situation in Ukraine and using our collective capacity to create this new thing. What is there any more you'd like to say about what's led you to open this Ukraine project up for us?
Yes, Kurt. Here this morning, I'm getting up, you know, with the jitters, ready to present. And then I'm looking at the news and I'm seeing and feeling what's going on. But I'm here drinking coffee and I said, I have to do something. We have to do something. And what can we do? Number one, we can capture their culture and start a cultural curation. Who knows what's going to happen with their schools, with their information. But right now, we can grab it, we can upload it, we can start. Number two, it's about sharing, because they're going to need us. Just like those over in Haiti and all in other across the world, they need open education resources. They don't have books. But again, we, our collective, and I'm so proud of you all. Again, I know I was off script, but I just thought that, Kurt, there was a need for us to do something about it. And I've been watching the chat. I've been watching my team upload those URLs. And ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to let you know we have over 25 entries for the Ukraine collection. This is a blessing, but you can see how with the HBCUs, we don't compete, we complete each other, Kurt. And we did something amazing today with this webinar.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Robbie. There are a couple of questions that we got from people before the event started. Maybe I'll pose these and see see what ideas people have. There was a question from Lurita about any specific information about what key coursework is most important right now in the HBCUs. What topics or other characteristics are you most focused on right now?
And I'm going to let my colleague, Dr. Monique Earl-Lewis, jump in because I think she said it best.
Well, thank you, Dr. Melton. We are very concerned about the assault on the restrictions of what individuals are able to learn these days. We're very concerned. We're very concerned about issues of social justice, inclusion, and equity. And at Morehouse College, we are committed to making sure that we are not only providing a good education, but developing leaders for the next generation and engaging them in the community. So through service learning, culturally relevant pedagogy, and I'm just so pleased with the ways in which Dr. Melton and Jerry Hanley have advanced this when we first became a partner in 2018. We have to have courses that reflect the lived experiences of all of our students. And it is not just to benefit students of color, African-American students, it's to benefit our white students, our Asian students, our Latinx students, who need to have an inclusive understanding of the history of this country and of the world. Because we know identity anchors our understanding about who we are and how we are to serve and learn. And so we just look forward to working with you and other members of the community through course redesign, engaging technology, looking at different learning modalities, and just bringing our best game to the table every time.
Yeah. Any other reflections on that topic? Anybody else want to jump in? Thank you, Dr. Earl-Lewis. There was a question we got from Brigid, I think I'm pronouncing the name right, about how we can connect students in Africa with students at HBCUs and what we could all be learning and teaching from each other. And, you know, maybe start with Africa, but just thinking even more broadly about how OER spans geographies and different cultures. What experiences might any of you have been having to date around spanning that sort of different communities?
And again, Kurt, that is the reason why we have Dr. Robert Castle, who is going to jump in, because we have a student initiative. Again, we concentrate, and we should, on faculty. But again, our end result is to help students. So we now have a student initiative for OER, and it is spreading not only between the HBCUs, but across the world. So I'm gonna let Dr. Hassel jump in and say something about our student need for open education resources.
I am so excited about the student education and the resources because our program here and our initiative, our Cultural Heritage Collections program, it helps our institutions meet the complex challenge of preserving large and diverse holdings of humanities materials for future generations by supporting them in their academic programs to help them actually access the benefit of these research tools and develop unique strategies and approaches to assist them in constructing their learning experience as they matriculate. It is so important that we make students aware of the endless possibilities, not only for OER to supplement their learning materials, but to enhance their overall experience in the classroom as well. Back to you, Dr. Melton.
And back to you, because I know we're at the 1 minute point. Let me just say, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you. I thank MIT, I thank the Hewlett Foundation, and of course, Merlo. But my HBCU sisters and brothers, again, we were able to bring to you our passion and our purpose. And again, yes, it's about the HBCU for this webinar, but we're talking about underserved population. We're talking about access at any time, any place, anywhere. And I want to thank all of you who helped contribute to the Ukraine, because now you can leave here and say, I did something. So again, we thank you on behalf of HBCUs. Together, we complete and we definitely share.
Yeah, thank you so much, Robbie. That's I can't think of anything else to say to take us out. That was it. That was the best. Just great appreciation for joining us today. And as I said at the beginning, we expect this is the first of what will be many conversations. And stay tuned for more of these in the months and years to come. Wish you all.
And life is good. Life is good.
Thank you.
Indeed.